Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Oh, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. Great are you, Lord, and how lovely, how lovely you are. How lovely, how lovely, how lovely you are. Oh, how lovely. How lovely, how lovely you are. Oh, how lovely, oh, how lovely, oh, how lovely you are.
Lord Jesus.
Oh, how lovely. Oh, how lovely, oh, how lovely,
Jesus, we worship you.
You are,
Lord Jesus, we worship you. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory now. Fill me, fill me. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory, and you filled me. You filled me. Oh, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory, and you filled me. You filled me now. You fill me now, oh God. You fill me with your presence and your love. You fill me now, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we worship only you, Jesus. Filled with every good thing, oh Lord Jesus. You fill us now. You fill me now. Jesus, you fill me now. Jesus, you fill me now. Jesus, you fill me now. God of heaven and God of life, Jesus. Oh, God of heaven and God of life, Jesus. Oh, God of heaven, Jesus Christ, Lord Jesus. Oh God of heaven, God of life, God of life, Jesus. Oh God of heaven and God of life, Jesus. Oh God of heaven, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, Lord, Lord Jesus. Oh God, my Savior, Redeemer, Jesus, Jesus. God, my Savior. Oh God, my Savior, Redeemer, Lord Jesus, God of heaven. Oh God of heaven, our Lord of life, Jesus. God of heaven, oh God of heaven, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus, God my Savior, God my Savior, Redeemer, Lord Jesus.
God of heaven,
God of heaven,
Lord of life, Jesus, God, God of heaven, Lord of life, Lord of life, God, my Redeemer, oh God, my Savior, my Redeemer, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, God, my Redeemer, oh God, my Redeemer, my Savior, Lord Jesus.
Well, we welcome all of you here this morning. We just want you to know that unless you have Christ Jesus, you're dead while you live. And you may have you may feel like you have a good life or that you may have a happy life. But the reality of it is the one who knows said that unless you have Christ Jesus, you're dead while you live. He that has Christ Jesus has life, and he that does not have him is dead while they live. And there's many people that have come just part way to him. They just came as far as religion. And it really didn't do anything for them. And we've had too many. We build bastions of religion. We build kingdoms of religion. But Father's inviting us into a place with him where we're filled up with his presence, filled up with his glory, and live out what Jesus described in his word, those things which he testified of, that we would have abundant life, life to the full, which is an continuous expression of his divine power and glory flowing through us. Jesus described it like rivers, because there was no other way to talk about how much he would give us of his presence and how it would flow through our lives with such glory. So the only way he could talk about it, because it was of so much abundance and it was so ending and unending and it was so continuous. I mean, just think about it. When you're trying to think of something that is so abundant and so unending and so continuous, hey, rivers is a good thing to come up with to describe that. And God wants you to know how good it is to live.
God wants you to know how good it is to be alive in Him. Father wants to break off the yoke and the appearance of humanity and fill you with heaven's glory. Oh God of heaven, oh Lord of light, Jesus, God of heaven, O Lord of life, Jesus, God my Savior, oh God my Savior, my Redeemer, Lord Jesus, God my Savior, God my Savior, my Redeemer, Jesus. See, this name carries with it such power that it has conquered death. Jesus said, those who believe in me will never taste death. When my body breathes out its last breath, I won't taste death. I go right from where I'm at, right into the realms of His glory. I will never taste the pains of death. Because that's what the author of life described. And we don't want to leave anybody out of this. God doesn't want to leave anybody out. He made it so easy. He vested all power and authority within the framework of a name that is so easy to pronounce that all death and hell and sickness and disease and everything that belongs to that realm has to flee at the name, has to go at the name. The yoke is broken by the name. Father vested in the name of Jesus all power and authority, and has highly exalted Him. Hallelujah. That by the name of Jesus Christ, men who are absolutely unacceptable to God, the way you were born is absolutely disqualified. It's unacceptable to God. It's too much like a demonic realm. But Father, through the miracle of salvation, made it such that if anybody would call upon the name of Jesus, suddenly a miracle would take place in their life and they'd become everything that is holy and acceptable to God. What a miracle. Somebody said, well, why can't there be many ways? Because there's only one. I hope that's simple enough. Somebody said, how do you know? Here's how I know. Because there's only one Almighty God who came and bore our sin and vested all power and authority in Him. So that every power of darkness, every power of death could be removed. He was the, listen, I'm dead right now. He's the first one who died and conquered death and came back from the grave. There were others that had been raised from the dead prior to Jesus, but He's the only one who came, said, I'm going to die for your sins, and I am going to die, and I'm going to destroy the power of death by myself. I'm going to do it. So that anybody who will believe in me will not be under the yoke and the power of death either. He's the only one that ever did that. He's the only one that ever said that. And then raised up from the dead 3 days later and was seen by many witnesses. And the witnesses were so strong that it's lasted 2,000 years and it's been proven over and over and over and over again by people like myself whose lives have been changed by the power of His name. And not only that, but in His name.
sickness and diseases have been broken off by the hundreds of billions. Proof in and out every day that Jesus is exactly who he said he would be and who he is. The one, the author of life, the author and the finisher of life, the one whom God the Father created all things by, the one who came and through death destroyed him that had the power of death so that you and I might experience and receive the resurrection life that he proved and testified of when he was raised from the dead 3 days after having been put to death and buried. And then was seen alive for more than 40 days. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He was seen alive for more than 40 days by more than 500 brethren. Till he ascended up on high and went into the Father. And I love the passage where the angels say, "Why stand ye gazing up into heaven?" Get busy. Why stand ye gazing up into heaven? For this same Jesus. Woo! Shall return in like manner as you have seen him go. Go tarry in Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. This is what he said. You shall be endued with power. Not many days from now. Hallelujah. And about 10 days later, about 10 days later, the most extraordinary thing happened. Men were invited into a holy union with God that goes far beyond what Adam had. Oh, yeah. Yeah. That angels can't even look into who desire to understand, but it surpasses them. Oh, their Father has made us one with him in such a way. And there's been many wrong representations of that. And there's many wrong influences and models. But that doesn't matter nothing. Go read the Bible and expect what you read in the Bible to be what you live out and what you have and what you experience. And if you'll contend for it, if you'll stand up against it, and I'm going to talk to you this morning about this. You'll stand up against every hindrance and everything that says, no, you can't have it, and everything that tries to describe some other kind of living. And everything that Father has said surely be established in your life. Father, we thank you. Oh God, I am, oh Lord of life, Jesus, God my Savior, God my Savior, my Redeemer, my Redeemer, Jesus, oh Jesus. All power's in your name, Jesus, Lord Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus, we worship you, Lord.
I yield myself to you. Let your rivers flow out of me. Holy Ghost, I yield myself to you. Let your rivers flow out of me. Holy Ghost, I yield myself to you. I let your rivers flow out of me. Holy Ghost, I yield myself to you. Let your rivers flow out of me. For you are all I sing. And my heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me. For you are all I see. My heart belongs to you. Holy Spirit, come fall afresh on me. For you
the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter of my head. You're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter of my head. You're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory. You're the glory and the lifter of my head. And I'll sing about your goodness, and I'll sing about your mercy, and I'll sing about your unfailing love. About your goodness, and I'll sing about your mercy, and I'll sing about your unfailing love. Oh, my son, I
about your goodness, and I'll sing about your mercy, and I'll sing about your unfailing love. You're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter of my head. Glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter of my head. You're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter, you're the glory and the lifter of my head.
And worthy, just and worthy is the Yes, worthy is the Lamb, Christ Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus. Oh, worthy is the Lamb, Christ Jesus. Oh, worthy is the Lamb.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mangara rashikara namandelele beya ramahan. Highest, lift your voice in praises. I will worship you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
I will worship you, Jesus. I will worship you, Lord Jesus. I worship you. I worship you. I praise your holy name, Jesus. We worship you. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you. We praise your holy name. Lord, we worship you. We worship you. Lord, we worship you. We praise your name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Kama mananja sakedi di pira sharada. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Mambra tateki arada namaseti. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the overflowing of your presence in our life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. I prazo tolololo makasta tenede di bikindo tolololo baharra babasa tiyefra. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. There's so many today in this place right now. There's a number of you. You just really don't even know how to connect with him at all. And the Lord wants to change that. There's some of you who you've learned how to connect with the Holy Ghost to a certain degree, but it's not on a consistent basis. It's kind of in and out, in and out. And I just want you to understand, that's not the abundant life that Jesus is talking about. And so we're here to help you today. We're not here to try to tell you what you don't have. We're here to give you an opportunity to have what he's desiring, fill you. And if you'll just listen, if you'll just listen and obey, if you're willing to stand up against those things that oppress you and oppose your life, you have all heaven on your side. You have all the power and the authority that is vested in the name of Jesus to be there, to break off the yoke. You may be seated. You can be seated. You know, I look at some of you, and I'm going to just be very honest with you. I look at some of you, and I recognize there's just a couple of people that unless things change in your life, you won't make heaven. You're not going to make heaven. And for some people, it seems that that's okay. It's not really okay. It's not okay. It's just the deception's got has grabbed a hold of you on such a level that you can't even deal with the reality of it. You just live for the now. You just live for what's going on right now. You just live and you're consumed with your earthly interest, and that's going to take you nowhere. It's not going to take you anywhere. And I'm glad that you came to the meeting today. You know, and I'm glad that you're here. But you don't want to play around with God. Because every time you resist the anointing and every time you decide not to go all the way with God, all you're doing is hardening your heart. You know, one of the things that I look at when I see people that are so trapped in deception, one of the things that stands out to me is this: how clueless they are about their spiritual state, first. And secondly, Lord, is there a possibility that that's going on in my life in any way? Yeah. And it drives me to my knees. And the good news is that anything that drives you to your knees and you're crying out desperately and saying, Holy Ghost, I want everything that you have, and I don't want anything that belongs to deception. The Spirit of Truth has come to lead us and guide us into all the truth. But if you're not driven to your knees out of hunger and thirst for the things of the Spirit, if you're not driven to your knees out of a hunger and thirst for the reality of God to fill your life, it's just proof of your deception, that you're deceived. The same drives me to the Word of God, to hear. So I just open up the Word of God, I open up the Bible, and I say to the Lord, speak to me, because that's how He speaks to us. He speaks to us in His Word. That's why we're constantly encouraging people, continually read through the Bible, not just your favorite verses, not just a spot check. When you get to Revelation 22:21, start back again at Genesis. It's a blessing. You know, I've discovered you can have several Bible studies going on simultaneously. I do several types of things, like, you know, let me give you an example. You can have a one-year program going on, which just demands that you read 2-3 chapters a day, which you can do in 5 minutes. Your Bible's read in a year. Then at the same time, you can have sequentially going on to that a 60-day program where you're reading the Bible in 60 days. And what's really good about that is that the slow-paced one that you're reading the Bible in a year, it allows you to meditate a little bit more. The other one, you're just kind of reading fast to get through, as it were. Because what's going to happen is the Holy Spirit knows exactly what your problem is, and in 60 days He can get to you. And all of a sudden you're just reading along and you can go real fast for most of the time. This, all of a sudden the Scripture just jumps up and grabs a hold of you and pulls you down to the Bible and says, this is what you need. And then, of course, those of you who continually come to the meetings, I know some people come on Sunday morning and that's it, you know, and some of you have a right and a good excuse for why you do that. But you know, the reality of it is you want to be in all the meetings. Amen. I want to be on the meetings, and it's because I want to hear from the Lord. And that's why the Lord said in the context, when you see the day approaching, assemble yourself all the more together. Why? Because of the level of deception, the level of lies, the level of distraction, the level that Satan would impose upon us. Jesus said, unless the day be shortened, even the very elect would be deceived. And so many folks have never really stood up to the issues that have harassed them all their life. The sadness, the sorrow, the upset. Hey, it's rare that people have many friendships that lasted, real true deep relationships that last more than 5 years. And then, of course, then that's getting over into marriage relationships more than ever before as well. Because they've never stood up against their own issues and their own problems, their own hurt. People that are hurt, if I said right now to Brittany, Brittany, I want you to ask the Lord forgive you of your hurt and your offenses. You know what she would do? She would immediately say, Lord, forgive me of my hurt and offenses, because she doesn't have any hurt and offenses that's going to make her argue. She's going to be like, oh, really, Pastor? Okay, Lord, forgive me my hurt and offenses. If you got a problem, you're not going to say it because you're deceived. You're not going to say it because the hurt and offenses create a wall. And many people live in that mess. If I said to Anna, I want you right now to repent of your stubbornness and your rebellion, she would be crying out to God. She'd be crying. If she thought I was saying that to her for true, she'd be sobbing because she's not deceived. She's not in a fenced wall of deception. Say it to someone who's in a defensed wall of deception. They'll argue with you. They'll tell you all those, you know. Of course, usually the Lord doesn't even let us talk to people on an individual basis that way. Usually we don't. We just can only say it in general, because the Lord deals with people's hearts in such a way to bring them to a place of repentance, because many times when we address people that are in that, they only become more defiant. They only become more hardened against God. And so the Lord, in His mercy, just lets people just, as it were, soak on the hard ground. You know what I'm saying? And reality of this is, I'm trying to tell you something about all the stuff that you allow that keeps you back from all the goodness that God has for you. Father has given to us so much goodness, invested all that power and authority simply in the name of Jesus. So people have asked me, well, said, how is it that you conquered sickness and disease, certain sicknesses and diseases, you know, that everybody else gets? Because I stood up to it in the face of it in the meeting. I came to the meeting. Amen. I stood in this. Look, listen to me. I stood in its face until it couldn't influence me anymore. How did you deal with sin and iniquity? I stood in its face until it couldn't harass me. Amen. I stood in its face resisting it, saying no to it, till it couldn't harass me anymore. How? By the name and the power and the authority of Jesus, not by human discipline, because human discipline ain't going to do nothing. You never, if you don't know how to rely upon the Holy Ghost, you're never going to get anywhere. Listen, if I can get men, and of course I have to come up against humanism to do this, And the power of humanism that so saturates even the mind of God's people today is astronomical. I mean, literally, it's a great word for it. It's astronomical. But when I try to come up and tell people, you aren't good enough for heaven, it's just like, what? Well, if I'm not good enough for heaven, then I will. You're not. You're not good enough for heaven. You just never encountered the holiness of God. Your whole problem. All you've got is encountered people around you, and you're always fighting and fussing and arguing. Our people are not always fighting and fussing and arguing, which is a good expression. Huh? Fighting and fussing and arguing, are they not? Yes. Are they not? Yes. And then why? That's not life. That's not blessing. That's frustration. That's a demonic realm. That's the powers of darkness opposing you, trying to keep you from the things, and you're allowing it. It's not happening outside of you, your will and your submission. You're allowing it because you're not willing to stand up against bad attitudes. You're not willing to stand up against harassing, tormenting spirits. You just let it run right over top of you. You live by your mind, your thinking realm, instead of God's thinking realm. And that's what we just always point to our mind. You know, that's just it's an allegory. Just like the heart is an allegory for the inner man. The mind is an allegory for the thinking realm of men. God wants us to learn by His thinking realm, where we make our decisions based upon what He said. And I say, okay, I'm going to go to church because God told me to be there. I'm practicing for the catching away. I'm practicing for going to heaven. I'm practicing to hear His voice. I'm practicing to do His will. I'm making those things that belong to the kingdom and His righteousness first in every way. Otherwise, what's going to happen is I'm going to drift. I used to spend a lot of time on the water when I was a teenager, not only surfing, but also sailing. And you can drift so easy. You learn how quickly to have landmarks on the shore. You learn how to orient yourself real quickly, so long as you're navigating based off of just the shore, because you drift so quick. All of a sudden, you're just sitting there, or just hanging out and, you know, sailing around a little bit or on your surfboard, and just something beautiful caught your attention, and next thing you know, you're way off course. Way off course. It happens to people spiritually all the time, and my heart goes out for you. I'm telling you right now, I don't stand here. So there's a couple of you. I don't want to stand here and argue with you. I'm not going to. I'm not going to stand here and argue with you. I want to tackle you, pin you down to the ground, and say, don't you realize what you're doing to yourself? Don't you have any understanding of what's going on in your life? But I can't do it. I want to. I know that God can do it to a certain degree, you know, because, you know, a lot, right? The messengers of the Lord force them. So I say, you can't force me. Well, it depends on your relationship with the Lord and what's going on. You talk about force. You talk about control. They laid hold on Lot and his family and, as it were, drug them out of the city because it couldn't be destroyed. Somebody said, well, my sin's not so bad that it needs to be destroyed. Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah, it is. And God just made a way for it to be completely destroyed because He came for the purpose of destroying it. And He's the only one who's destroyed it. And all power and authority is vested in that name. That the name of Jesus, sin and disease and sickness and death is destroyed by the power of that name. And the more you and I who know Him and are filled with the Holy Ghost participate with that, we grow in a relationship faith that gives us a place in God to speak to the dead and command them to rise again. To where every time the opposing forces of darkness have to obey. But how about all the things we allow continually to influence us that are not the direction of the Holy Ghost and the authority that is in that name? Then what happens is we find ourselves contained, stopped, hindered, prevented, because we allow stuff to go on and influence our decision and influence our attitude that are of the same nature and of the same category. And now we're going to think that we're going to stand up against this bigger, as it were, hindrance and this bigger opposing force and tell it what to do, when, as it were, minor opposing forces have authority over our life. It doesn't work that way, people. It doesn't work that way. We got to deal with opposing forces in our life that keep us from doing the very obvious thing that God tells us to do and not to do. One of the obvious things that God tells us to do in relationship with Him is to love Him with everything that is within us, to be willing to do whatever He desires of our life. And that should in itself be for us an ability to make every decision in God. But it isn't, because people don't know how to live in that relationship love. Then all you're doing is you're saying, you know, the prayer goes beyond, Lord, Your will be done in this earth as it is in heaven. And believe you me, the majority of times in the Scripture, both Old Testament and New Testament, when the phrase "in this earth" is used, it's really talking about the human being, the terrestrial creation of God that He formed from the fine dust of the earth. We say, Father, Your will be done in my life, in this earth, as it is in heaven. We're saying then, I'm not going to live by my own will anymore. That's what we're saying. I'm going to do Your will from here on in. And Father has told us very clearly what His will is. Over and again, I tell people, if you just did nothing more then take Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 and devote yourself to living that out. First and foremost, you would discover real quickly that without complete and total reliance on the Holy Ghost, you're not going to get anywhere. You're not going to do it. Huh? People think that they can live their own lives and they'll be acceptable to God, and as a result, they never come to depend upon the Holy Ghost. You have to confront the reality that you can't do what God's called you to do without Him. You can't do what is pleasing unto God unless you get a heart change, unless you get a spirit change. And the Lord didn't leave it there. He didn't just say just a heart change and a spirit change. He said, I'm going to put my Holy Ghost on the inside of you. I'm going to put my spirit. I'm going to take heaven and I'm going to fill you with heaven. He says, first and foremost, no man is acceptable in his sight. No man could draw nigh unto him. But then God in his mercy opens up to us a door and an access through that work of grace, which he did when he destroyed the devil, when he destroyed the power of darkness. And we watch as our children slip away. Are you texting? Good. Watch as our children, because I don't want you to slip away. I want to make sure. I want to make sure that your dad's watching you. I want to talk to your parents. I want to make sure that you're watching your children. I look at too many places. I go and the pastor's children all the way down to just the visitor's children have no interest in God. They sit bored in the meeting. They have no way to connect with the anointing. And even dad, the pastor, is just a Holy Ghost-filled man. And mom, she may be full of the Holy Ghost, that visitor. But her children are completely prisoners of darkness. They have no understanding, not even a slight conceptual concept of what it means to interact with the realms of heaven. That is the great tragedy. That is a great tragedy. I tell you right now, your kids are going to turn out worse than you are. And you're forming them. Or they're going to turn out better than you are. And you're forming them. My children turned out better than I am. Hallelujah. Way better than both of us, Mom says. Praise God. Because we made sure that they understood how to flow in the Holy Ghost. We made sure we laid our hands on them full of the Holy Ghost. Until they felt the presence of the living God. Feel that? I'd ask them, huh? Yesterday we performed a marriage ceremony, and so all I wanted, I didn't really care about a whole lot of things going on. Of course, I wanted to see many hard hearts that were there turn and soften and break before the presence of the Lord, and we prayed and interceded for the purpose and continue to pray and intercede that will happen. But my bigger thing was just getting Tyler and Lindsay over into the realms of glory. So that they could have a touch of heaven in that marriage to begin with at the moment of vow and consecration. So I just stood there with my hands on them until they were holding hands. I stood there with my hand on them until both of them went past their nervousness and jitters and all the other stuff that goes on and began to be overwhelmed with the glory of God. I just watched their face until I could see. Yep, there we go. That's what I'm going after. Well, it's the same thing with my children. Same thing with our family. Same thing with my wife. If I sit here for a few minutes? Huh? Yeah, because we want to teach you how to plug into a realm that we've been given access to by Christ Jesus. Not a religious ideology, another philosophy, another thing that we hope would work, that would change in our lives and bring the presence of God into our life, but the living reality of the power of God. And if you're going to sit isolated in your own concepts and beliefs or try to mix what God says in His Word with what your ideas are or someone else's ideas, it's never going to work. We come His way. In His way, God doesn't need any advice. His way is very strict, and few there be that find it. As always, it's a sad thing. The Lord Jesus said, well, when the Son of Man returns, will He find any faith on the earth? That should cause you and I great concern. Not about everybody else, but about us. Will the Son of Man, when He returns, find any faith on the earth? He's looking out into the future. He sees the condition, spiritual condition of men. And it's such a heartbreak. He sees the spiritual condition of men and says, the way that leads into life is narrow, and there be few that find it. And then we have to get out of our old arrogant self and say, am I one of the few? Hello? Because knee-jerk reaction says, well, that's me. I'm one of the few. Are you with me? But hey, does it line up with what God says? Are you having the experience that he described? Do you have within you a wellspring springing, continually providing for you the very life of God? Because we want to make it into something other than what it is. He said, you drink of the water which I give to you, and it shall be a well springing up on the inside of you of eternal life, which is the life of God. For Jesus is personified. Eternal life is personified by Jesus in 1 John 1:3. We know that already. Well, I'm going to wait to 1 John 1:3. It's the very life of God, the life of the Holy Ghost, the life of the Spirit is the life of God. And he's placed within us the very resonant glory of heaven that produces all the life of God. I'm going to tell you, all of his nature, all of his character, all the things that we call the fruits of the Spirit, his humility. Listen, Jesus basically tells us we don't even get started until we learn how to walk in lowliness and in humility. He says, come and learn of me. Come understand who I am. I'm meek and lowly. Oh, then you know, that's where we start. We have to just look and see, how do we respond in adversity? How do we respond to leadership? Are we meek and lowly? Or are we arrogant and proud? Or are we always defending ourselves? Or are we those people who always bow? I watch people get endometriosis. I watch them bow to the pain. They never stand, they can't stand up against it. Pain's too great. Are you listening to me? If you've got endometriosis and you're watching me by web, I'm not speaking, trying to hurt you or speak ill of your situation. I'm telling you, you can stand up. Yes. You say, no, you can't. No, you can't. I understand that pain is immense. But there's a way to stand up and face the thing and not have to bow to it. And I think that endometriosis is one of those things that really has an expression of bowing. Jesus saw a woman who was bowed over by the pain. You ever seen an old woman bowed over by arthritic pain? What an expression of bowing to demonic power. Same thing happens in attitudes. Same thing happens in emotions. Same thing happens in relationships. People bow to something so terrible and so evil. And we want to teach you how, by the Spirit of the Lord, to be able to stand up against it, because God has given us something that breaks off every yoke, and it's his anointing, but it only flows in a certain way. It's not going to be, it's God's way, and God's Spirit will never be mixed with anything else. God's working, God's word, God's thinking will never be mixed with ours and result in what he wants. But in his mercy and his love, he continues to deal with us. He continues to work with us until we're willing to let it just be his will. And we say, no more with my will. My goodness, you're now a slave of the Lord Jesus Christ, a servant of Almighty God under his sovereign rulership. Many people have been raised in their house and they didn't have authority in their house, and they never were taught how to come under a place of obedience. They lived as wild brats and grew up to be adult brats. Nobody can tell me what to do. Yeah, they can. His name is Jesus. Yeah, the Holy Ghost can. And it's not mano y mano, because you're not going to hook up with them like that. You're going to hook up with them through the church. That's the way the Lord designed it. Because you're never going to confront your real issues until you begin to interface with other people that you're going to have to love when they mistreat you, that you're going to have to respect and obey when they're over you. And all that is an interface with God. It's just an interface with God. That's why he said, how can you say you love God when you hate that you haven't seen, when you hate your brother that you have seen? How can you say you submit to God who you've not seen, when you won't submit to leadership that God said you're supposed to honor them and give them double honor because they have the rule over you. They rule you. Uh-oh. Dial 911. Somebody's coming up against our spirit of humanism and self-exaltation. People then got all the excuses. Well, I don't want to be controlled, and I don't want to be, you know, told what to do, and I can't really trust, and all the other nonsense, which is irrelevant, because now it's tried to be confined within the framework of some bad experience or something that some charlatan did by the abuse of authority.
Forget about it. Go to the Word of God. What does God tell you to do? If you do what you do under the Lord, He's going to make sure that He takes good care of you. He's promised to. I mean, I got all kinds of situations around me that I don't understand. One of the house church leaders, a young man, he's really only in his 40s. And, of course, that's young when you turn 57. It's right, you think. And instantly died yesterday in a car accident. And I don't understand that, but it ain't going to change my theology. It ain't going to change what I believe about God. God's going to protect me. He's going to protect me. I don't know how that happened. I don't know why that happened. And there's no discussion on it in the Word. And so it isn't for me to even think about it. I'm going to think about the Word, you see. I don't know anything about that. Somebody wants to give me an explanation. Can't give you one. Don't know anything about it. Let me tell you what God says. Let me tell you about He's going to protect you. Let me tell you about how He's going to provide for you. Let me tell you about how He's going to perfect you. Somebody says, oh, well, what about this issue and that issue and how that, you know, we're still, you know, I'm constantly being tripped up by sin and iniquity or sickness and disease. I don't know about that. Let me tell you what God will do for you if you will allow Him. If you'll let Him take you and develop you and teach you and guide you. If you'll begin to respond to the Holy Ghost, the very spirit of the anointing. And let me just begin to quickly, because I know some of you I only have just a little bit of time with here today, because I'm already imposing on you. There's a couple of people that say, I'm just being honest. I want to confront you. I want to tell you how I feel about it and what's happening in the dynamics of what I experience in the realms of the Holy Ghost, many times interfacing with folks. And they don't know that what their attitudes are. Many people don't know. They don't know that their attitudes are directed towards God. They just think it's all about the here and the now and what's going on and the dynamics of the fact that they've got other things to do and they're sitting on Sunday morning and in the meeting and hurry up. And it just seems I'm on that. Let me just tell you, there's several hurry up churches in San Diego, and I just really would invite you to go there. I don't want to name them because I don't want to bring any kind of, you know, shadow them with some kind of disrespect, you know what I'm saying? But they'll get you out in 30 to 45 minutes and there won't be any responsibility over your head. You'll be treated as, you know what I'm saying? But here, I'm going to get in your space. I'm going to get in your space. And because you're here, you're messing with me. You're messing with the anointing in my life. You're messing with the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to talk to you about the things that are holding you back from all the goodness of God and making you maybe even a false witness, because I don't know how many people you're telling that you are full of the Holy Ghost and you're not. Is that what it means to be full of the Holy Ghost? You mean that's what it means to have life abundantly, what you are? You know, I don't want to go too far down that line. But I pray that you'll listen to me. I pray that you listen to me, because if you will, everything will change instantly. That's the way it is with God. That's the way it is with His Word. That's the way it is with the Holy Spirit. You be willing to take what He says and make it what you are, and you change instantly. Instantaneously, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And then in that, He begins to develop us and make us strong and make us in every way able to deal with everything that we have to confront, from sin to disease. But let me just talk to you about the anointing that breaks the yoke, the anointing, the authority that God has given us to deal with everything that would oppose the kingdom of God. And you know, if you look, and I'll just give you an overview, because if you look from Genesis to Deuteronomy, basically the anointing is expressed on the basis of the ability for a priest, an anointed person, to come and stand before the presence of God and minister to Him. And there was just a few. Moses, hallelujah. Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, didn't work out good for them. Why? They altered the things of God. They altered the things of God. And He said, no, anybody who comes near me, I will be sanctified in their midst. It will be shown that their lives are 100% consecrated to what I say, my way and my will. And I think that's beautiful. Humanism says, I don't like that. It's not a dictatorship and it's not a tyranny. It's God saying, you can't live that way and have life. You can't act that way and, and be over here in that which I created. That looks too much like the demonic power that has rebelled against me and created all the problem to begin with. I want to show you how to live. I want to show you how to walk in the ways of life. So Nadab and Abihu, they got the lightnings of God at church that day, but it was the lightnings of God that resulted in their death and not in their blessing. Huh?
Yes.
The fire of God came out, and we know that the fire of God comes out as lightning. Because Eleazar and Abithar went in there and drug them out by their tunics. Fire God destroyed them, but they were completely whole. Their outer garments completely whole. And they drug them out by their tunics. You know, if I could get everybody, if I could get everyone in this place here today, everyone that's a part of this church, it comes in and out, some regularly, some irregularly, some on Sunday nights, some on Wednesday nights. If I could just get, I mean, the list is huge. It's a pretty big list. It's of how many people believe that this is their church and they call me their pastor. I can't even, I mean, they wouldn't fit in this room right now. If I could get all of God's people that say that they're part of the abiding place and part of this ministry to come in to and be with one heart and with one mind, we'd take this nation. If you could just get that any place. I mean, because somebody said, how do you know? Because precedence has been set. 120 people turned the world upside down. 120. 120. In fact, it actually says in the Greek language, approximately 120. Huh? Think about it, dear people. Probably because one person was in and out. I don't know. But they did a head count one day over the periods of 10 days. And well, we got 118 today. And then, you know, next day is, but I'm leave that alone. Okay. Approximately 120. Turn the world upside down.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. See, for me, you know what it does when I see all this? It causes me to realize what's holding me back. Because I see it in other people. They don't even see it in themselves. And I see it and I go, oh. I'm still living in my own thinking too much, huh, Lord? I'm still making my own decisions too much, huh, Lord? I'm still processing what you said and making it work and fit into my life, huh, Lord? Lead me in the way everlasting. I want it all your way. Thy will be done. I'm not going to have my will. And then it's going to be challenged on very basic ways with very basic issues in my life. And I've just got to learn how to submit to Him, submit to His Word, to recognize, wait a minute, my provider is here, my protector is here. I'm going to learn how to give thanks when I don't get my way. I'm going to learn how to give thanks and praise Him when it ain't working out like I want it to work out, when the enemy is harassing me and trying to say this or that. And so many people just deal with that. They never get past condemnation. They never get past harassment. They never get past Satan trying to minimize the anointing in their life. Because that's what he does. He tries to marginalize you, make what you have very little in respect to what everybody else has. That's nonsense. Everybody's got the same anointing. Jesus, one Holy Ghost, one anointing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And somebody said, yeah, that's why I don't have to listen to leadership. You don't have the anointing. Because the anointing would have said just the opposite of that. Are you listening? See, people have misunderstood what God has for them. And I just bring that out because I want to point these things out because I've discovered that people don't hear right. They try to make everything that is said fit into their lives, and it doesn't. Because they live in a place where they're not interfacing with the Word of God and the correction of the Word of God and the correction of the Holy Ghost. And when you do, you enjoy the correction. It also comes from every other place where the Spirit of the Lord speaks. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
The instruction from where the Spirit of the Lord speaks. When you fall in love in the anointing and you see the anointing, you lay hold on the anointing. And that's ultimately what's going to result in increase in your life. That's what happened with Elisha to Elijah. Now, the anointing was first given so that a person had the ability to interface with God, a divine power and ability to be able to stand in the presence of the Lord. So somebody said, well, anybody can stand in the presence of the Lord. No, you can't. You have to have a divine ability to stand in the presence of the Lord. And if there's anything if there's anything that is shown to us in Exodus chapter 8, huh? in Leviticus chapter 8, forgive me, and through 16, it just is emphasized the special anointing that you have to be able to stand before the Lord. A consecration, something that He alone can impart and give. And I want to tell you right now, Christ Jesus has given us that. We may not understand it. It may not be valuable and precious to us. We may not have even taken advantage of it.
That's right.
But it's there. It's ours. We can come in with all boldness into the holies of holies by the blood of Jesus Christ. I mean, I could go on and on with that. But then as you move out of Deuteronomy and you begin to move in and past Judges, Joshua and Judges, you begin to move into Samuel. You're beginning to move into the dimension of, as it were, the king. Suddenly, the anointing is expressed in a new way. Now there's a special anointing given so a person can be a leader of God's people. Suddenly, there's the anointing being expressed now that a person can be a spokesman for the Father, prophet. You see, the king and the prophet anointing emerges together, beginning in 1 Samuel. You see the power of the anointing, the special ability that God has given. He gave, look at what he did. He gave to David a special anointing, and that anointing resulted in his ability to drive out the enemies that stood opposing God's people and the blessings that God had given them.
Yeah.
That's what the anointing does. The anointing gives to us the ability to break off the yoke. You know, we talk about the anointing shall break off the yoke. From Isaiah. Well, that really is in context to dealing with the Antichrist. The Syrian, the man of sin. Even in the worst situation, the most evil expression of the most demonic person, the anointing will break off that yoke. His harassment, his reach to try to grab a hold of us and rule over us and impose upon us his tyranny. The anointing, that's what the anointing is given for. And I'll jump real quickly because I don't want to wait. The anointing is given to us, and the anointing tells us and teaches us and gives us the wisdom and the ability to literally abide and dwell in Christ Jesus. We don't need any man to teach us, but the anointing that we've received of him teaches us all things, even as it has taught us that we are to dwell in Christ Jesus. Everybody know the verse of Scripture? Huh? Anybody know the verse of Scripture? Anybody give me the scriptural reference of that jewel in 1 John? Huh? Can anybody give me the scripture reference? I want you to grab a hold of the Word of God. I want you to get the Word of God in you. Yeah. I mean, come on, people. Listen, if there's any verse of scripture you need to memorize, it's that one. Because it's so important to us. Because so many people believe so many different things about what it means to be saved and be born again and have a walk with God. And these are things like this Word of God that is power and authority. Understand the Word is spirit and life. And God is very clearly instructing us exactly how it's got to be done. We just think it's just all out there and we'll get to it later and it doesn't really matter because we're saved and born again, we're all good. No, wait a minute. Father says, do it exactly like I told you to do it. Understand, you can't add to it and you can't take from it. Every jot, every tittle, every word is sacred. You've got to be willing to be conformed, not only to the living word, Christ Jesus, but to the written word that describes everything about him. You hear me? Because if you and I, all of us, just sit around and we watch Jesus Christ, the living word, lived out his life, we would all have different ideas about what that looked like and how he did it. We would. Just as they did. And we might have different expressions about what we thought he meant. But the written word tells us exactly what he meant and exactly what he did and exactly how he did it. And he says, you want to follow me? Then do what I say to do. And we just go this general approach. Why? Because once again, we are being impacted by offending and opposing powers. The principality and powers that exist right now within the framework of the spirit of disobedience, the God of this world. How many of you think that you're not impacted or affected at all by the prince of the power of the air? Raise your hand. I'll give you a few more minutes. If you weren't, you wouldn't be tempted at all. Are you with me? Be no temptation at all. Comes right out of that realm. Then, and so just in general, and if I started getting into your lives of where you then are impacted and affected even more by the prince and the power of the earth, the god of this world, the spirit that now works in children disobedience, some of you would start squirming and get very uncomfortable and decide you're never coming back here because it's painful and it hurts. And no one wants to go back to something that is painful and hurting. By and large, are you listening to me?
Yes.
I personally do. When it comes to me dealing with the things that are going on in my life that are keeping me from walking the narrow way, which few find. I'm not interested in the broad path. It's traffic jam. It's gridlock. I'm telling you right now, the broad way that leads to destruction, everybody's going there. And fortunately, the word doesn't say everybody, because then we'd be real concerned. And it says many. Many versus the few. And I just want to challenge you today. Are you the many or are you the few? And if you're the few, you're learning how to do what the anointing, what the Holy Ghost, what God, Christ Jesus, has described for us to do, and you conform to Him in every way. You're willing to not be conformed to this world, but to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus. You're willing not to be conformed to this world, but transfigured by thinking different, thinking according to the Word. Because the Word of God gives us the mind of God. It gives us the mind of the Spirit. It's the mind of Christ. Father has given us a special divine ability where you and I can actually put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's the same word, enduo, the Greek word, to be endued with power from on high. We get endued. It's a fellowship. It is a relationship. You're not living on yesterday's manna. You're not living on yesterday's bread or yesterday's drink. It's a fellowship of a day in, day out fellowship. Your prayers from yesterday are bottled up, as it were, in the censers of heaven, and they're valuable and sacred to God, and He's not going to let any of them fall. But I'm going to tell you right now, it's the prayer for today. It's the life for today. It's the decision for today. And today's decision in God that is a right decision is going to make a more powerful and resolute decision tomorrow. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you do it God's way. Papa has his preachers, just like me, all over the world, speaking the exact same thing. Now, you can find a bunch of charlatans out there going to tell you, you're okay, you know, you'll be fine, don't worry about anything. God loves us all. Huh? You're going to find a bunch of people just come back and put your money in the offering basket. They're not going to go that far. But that's really what's going down to it, because it's for merchandising. It's trafficking. It's merchandising and trafficking, just like Satan did in Ezekiel 28. It's making merchandise out of people. It's not about your soul. It's not about where your walk. It's not about the glory of the Father, because Father has purposed that whatever we desire, we ask Father, and He will do it so that Jesus Christ may be glorified through us getting our answer to prayer, our answer, our request to the Father. I just ministered that on Wednesday night. If you didn't hear it, you want to know all the verses of Scripture, we've got it on YouTube. Just look at the Wednesday night service. Huh? Because that's what Father, we say, oh Lord, be glorified in my life. Well, He wants to be glorified in your life, but you're going to have to step into a relationship that goes to a little bit deeper dimension of faith, where you know that He hears you, where you see Him always before you, and on your right hand that you shall not be moved, where their interaction with you, with Him and you, becomes of sorts that you could walk through a wilderness at a dry and thirsty land with your hands raised high and praising Him. Hallelujah. Just like Moses did, not like the rest of them did. Huh? Everybody's ready to stone him. Look at this guy. Look what kind of leader is he. Led us to the bitter waters of Marah. You tell me you got the revelation of God, the inside of God. Here we are, our tongues are all swollen up, and our kids are about to die, and the animals are about to fall over dead. And here, this you led us to this great blessing of God, bitter water. Huh? What was Moses doing? No, he didn't have that, but he had an expression of that. He was standing there in the glory. Well, they're getting ready to stone him. He can't be of God. We'd never ended up over here. No, God brought you here to prove you and to try you. And you're going to be, yeah, you can have joy unspeakable and full of glory, but if needed, you're going to be in heaviness. And I look at a lot of Christians in heaviness, and I'm wanting to get them out of heaviness. Yeah. Through their many tribulations and sufferings and problems. Huh? So that the trying of their faith might be found unto praise and honor and glory, so that they can get things right in their life. Huh? Are you listening to me? It's important to Father. That's why I told Abraham, says, take your son and offer him for me. grab your son, grab your boy, and I'm going to show you where to make an offering, a human sacrifice out of him. And Abraham's heart was so knitted to the father, he said, okay, he grabbed him. And do like George C. Scott did in the dramatization, start agonizing. Ah, I hate that stuff. And he went on a three-day journey because Isaac was already dead. Three-day journey, he's going to get resurrected. He tells his servant, say, stay right here. My son and I, we're going to go over there and worship, and we will return unto you. Papa, Dad, where is the lamb? The Lord will provide himself a lamb. Takes a knife, and after he binds him, puts him on the wood, takes a knife and ready to jab it right into him because he had already, as it were, received him as already being resurrected. Because why? He's integrated with Father. He's integrated with the divine. He knows who God is. He knows God as the one who's so full of love and grace and power, the one who controls the ages, the one who's master of eternity, the one who allowed him to step into relationship with him, and there would be nothing that he would withhold from such a one. We don't know him like that, yet God has given us the ability to know him like that. Because many people won't go through the trial. They won't go through the wilderness. They won't go through the examination. They won't go through the hard places and find themselves praising him and continuing to hold fast and stand up against the opposing force and not bend nor bow nor move, but like a tree planted by the water, steadfast, they stand, not changing. Amen. There are only three out of the millions that would not bow to the idols. Three. I'm sure Daniel didn't either. He must have been in a remote country at the time. How are you listening to me? Only three. Only three out of the millions. Only two who was willing to give. Only two out of maybe 3 million people. Two made it into the inheritance. Joshua and Caleb. Few there be that find it. People want to modify it. They want to do it their own way. They want to back down when things aren't going good. Suddenly they want to modify it. They want to act like God has somehow forsaken them and left them alone. He hadn't forsaken you and left you alone. He forsook Jesus so that you would never be forsaken. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
He forsook the word. Jesus said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you abandoned me? Oh, katama seya patara. So that you and I would never be abandoned. He's not left us as orphans, but sent to us the Holy Ghost. And people still want to do it your own way. It's a violation against the Holy Ghost. It's a violation against him. You have to have a revelation before you're ever going to recognize how you offend and hurt God doing it your own way. How when he's giving you the most sacred and the most precious thing that no man had right to have. No man has a right to have except but by Jesus. And before, no man had a right to ever have. God anointed Aaron and anointed Moses. And he anointed Aaron's sons and the priesthood after them to be able to stand there in a holy place, trembling before his presence, to only enter in behind the veil once a year. And there it had to be so filled with smoke that they couldn't see nothing. Because if they saw anything, they should die. Because it's so sacred. Eyes cannot look upon it. Yet God, through the mercy of sending his only begotten Son and in the form of sinful flesh, took upon ours, his own self, all our sin, so that we could be completely cut off from the realms of the demonic, now to be completely 100% one and interactive with him. And we violate the word and we violate the Holy Ghost over and again and act like we've done nothing wrong. And yes, I'm hollering at you. And yes, I'm addressing the things that have made the church of very little significance in a modern age. And we better respond. I'm responding. I've responded. I'm afraid that a huge number of people, maybe even could be the majority, would not abide to hear this. They become so influenced by rebellion. They become so influenced by their own way. They become so integrated with humanism and says he can't talk to me that way. He's trying to make himself better than I am because it's all about comparisons and competitions, which is all demonic. Comparison, competition, and compromise is a demonic realm. Comparison, competition, and compromise, all a demonic realm. Has nothing to do with heaven. Comparison, competition, and compromise is a demonic realm. Has nothing to do with heaven. Comparison, competition, and compromise.
It is amazing how many people espouse it and wonder why there's so little anointing. People trample all over the Holy Ghost all day long and wonder why there's not a greater anointing.
People do it in a meeting, trample all over the and walk all over the anointing, walk all over the Holy Ghost, and wonder why there's not a greater manifestation of the power of God.
We need to wake up. We need to come up out of our sleep. Start praising Him. Start giving Him thanks. Huh? Start standing in the heat of the trial, in the fiery furnace of faith. Start letting Father have His will and have His way. Start obeying Him. Start putting the things in very practical ways, not esoteric, mystical ways, abstract ways, very practical ways. Hallelujah.
Then all of a sudden we look and we see, I believe it would be Mark 6:13. Before I give you that one, let me just look at one more obvious to you than that. Luke 4:18.
You know, before I do that, I feel very impressed of the Lord to have you turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 2 and verse 27, because I didn't really get much of a response about where is the passage. Scripture. Where is your jewels? Where are your treasures? Where are the sacred things to you?
I'm going to tell you right now. You start reading the Bible 5 minutes a day, 2 to 3 chapters a day. In 10 years, you would have gone through the Bible 10 times, and I guarantee you, you're going to have a whole lot more than what you have right now, just going through the Bible in just 10 times. But if you don't do what I'm telling you, in 10 years, you won't have gone through it once. That's just the way procrastination is, and God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. You're supposed to give all diligence to making your calling and election sure. If there's anything that we should be very focused on and very committed to and very consecrated to and very diligent with, and that is the ways of life that Father, the Holy Ghost has come to teach us how to walk in. Men of old said, show us where is the path of life and where is the place thereof. And now God has come with all of His glory to show us, and we're busy with other things. How does that impact heaven? How does that impact the purposes and the will of God being done in earth?
Oh, people, we're going to have to wake up and think a little deeper here. We're going to have to break past the veil of deception and the false representations and the wrong models that we've called good and right that then we've imitated and gone after, rather than being those who are brought up in the glory of Christ Jesus. Because I'm going to tell you right now, philosophies of men and traditions of men will spoil you after the rudiments of the world. In other words, the philosophies of men and traditions of men taught from the pulpit will make you more like the world than like Jesus. Spoil you. Spoil on a bad sense. Spoil like, woo! Them eggs have sat around too long. Huh? Are you listening? Listen to me. Huh? That meat sit in the refrigerator. Whoo, too long. It's not fit for the dogs. The salt has no savor.
People don't believe that Christ Jesus is going to completely reject lukewarmness. That He will, without hesitation, say, I do not know you, and cast you away from Him. You listen to me. It is, when we're talking about this particular idiom, Hebrew idiom, Middle Eastern idiom, one of the greatest things of insults you can give if someone is your enemy and you don't even want to be around them, and they hand you something to drink, you go, that is, get away from me, I want nothing to do with you. Spit it out. Jesus said, if you're lukewarm, I'll spit you out. That's what He's saying.
I'll spew you out. I'll show you. Get away from me. Nothing to do with you. I do not know you. People cannot even imagine, because they're so influenced by humanism, they can't even imagine that a loving God would respond to them in such a way. Wait a minute. Look at what he's all done for you, and look at how you've been responding to him. Hold up. Time out a second, you arrogant thing, you. Look at how you've been treating him. Look how you've been trampling, walking all over. Huh? The things of the Spirit. No, that's what the Lord says. He said, you trample underfoot the blood of Jesus Christ, bring him to an open shame, listen, and literally outrage the Holy Ghost. Has anybody seen the Holy Ghost angry? I can show you the Holy Ghost anger. People don't understand it. They don't understand it. Why? Your minds have been polluted. Your thinking polluted with the God of this world, the spirit of disobedience, the realms of humanism that cannot understand God of judgment, God who hates iniquity, God who holds things so sacred and so precious. We don't know that. Many of God's people don't even understand honor anymore. It's a forgotten characteristic. Honor. To speak something and say you're going to do it and do it even if it costs you your life. Hear me now. I'm telling you right now, everything about your life, God wants to change. And you've got to be willing to change. Real quickly, I want you to see this verse of scripture here in 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. Here's what the Lord says concerning the anointing. The anointing that we've received. Just as I said, the special anointing to be able to stand as a priest before God. It's something Father had to do. Otherwise, you're going to get fried. You'll die. Humanism will not allow people to realize or believe for a moment that they are that unlike God and that unqualified and that different and that unacceptable. But it is. The anointing then given to the king to drive out the enemies of God, to deal with every opposing force. The anointing given to the prophet to be able to speak out those things that are in the mind and heart of God and to know what's going to take place in the future. All these things we express in the anointing is now finds its full in Christ Jesus, and Christ Jesus has come to have that full, give us that full revelation and expression of the anointing. And we don't have time for these things, as it were, it seems. Got things too convoluted in our lives. And I'm crying out by the Spirit of the Lord to people that might hear. That says, wait a minute, Father, what belongs to heaven is more important to me than anything else. Your will is more important to me than anything else. The assignment you have for me is more important than anything else. The anointing that you died and rose again for me to have is more important than anything else. My privilege of walking with you and being one with you is far above all things that I could ever want or ask. I give myself completely and wholly devoted to doing what you want me to do, to walking in your will, to obeying you, to being taught of you. I pray that falls not upon deaf ears in this place. Because if it does, all that will happen is you will find yourself drifting further and further and further away as you justify your state. That's called self-righteousness. It's filthy rags. God wants to give you his righteousness, which is a consecrated life, to obey God and do what it is he said to do, no matter what it costs you, even if it costs you your life. I'm going to tell you right now, the deception will be so great in these last days that you cannot count your life dear unto yourself if you expect to escape it. The deception of these last days will be so great that the only way you'll overcome is by the blood of Jesus Christ. And you're going to have to understand the power of the blood, that death that was given, that power that was released when Christ Jesus destroyed Satan through death. You have to understand me. You have to understand me. The only possible way is that's integrated with the word of your testimony. Hallelujah. That's not just for the middle of the tribulation. That's for any days of deception. That's just the way the people of God live. They count their life not dear unto themselves. And I look around so many people so consumed with themselves. I look at people so full of themselves. I wanted to say, you so full of yourself, God, the Holy Ghost don't have a room. And they say that they baptized in the Holy Ghost. Man, you so full of yourself, I don't see a speck of anointing. I don't see a speck of the display of the power of God. Wish I could talk to people like that.
through it here and fall down immediately and repent instead of getting into some kind of self-defense? Are you listening to me? Yes. Because if it's a reaction of submission to God, we would fall down on our knees right there and everything would change. But much of the stuff, if it's not rebellion, it's a reaction of hurt and offense.
I just can't ever do nothing right.
The powers of hell so taken the heart and minds of those who had clean escaped damnation to entangle them again with another ploy of a demonic realm. Here's what the Lord says. He's given to us an anointing not to go stand in the holy place waiting for one day to stand in the holies of holies where you can't see anything as the priest is described about the priest. Not just an anointing to be king, to be able to drive out the enemies that would oppose God's people, or to be prophet, to be a prophet, to be able to speak right out of the realms of heaven, those things which are in the heart of the Father to the people. But he's given us an anointing to be able to dwell in the living God, to be one with God. Look here, right? This is what, you listening to the anointing? Well, if you listen to the anointing, I'm telling you right now, things are going to begin to change in your life, and things are going to begin to change through your life. And I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to step into all the blessings and benefits of what it means to be born again, raised up together with him, and seated in a heavenly realm. You're going to begin to experience what it means to live a life full of the fire of God and the glory of God, and not to live in the disappointment and despair of a human condition. People always talk about the human condition. I got removed from the human condition. I was given a divine nature. I'm a new creation. I'm a new man. Christ Jesus is my brother. I belong to the family of heaven. I've been translated, delivered from the past. Delivered from the darkness. Delivered from the realms of hell and those things that belong to the demonic, and translated in the kingdom of dear son. And I'm happy to be here. And I'm growing and maturing and being taught of God on a daily basis. And love every moment and say, Father, correct me. Yeah. Instruct me. Lead me, because that's what you've come to do. I want everything that you have for me. Yeah. Show me where I'm making my own decisions instead of obeying you and living by the Spirit and living by the Word. Listen to me. That's what the anointing has come to teach us. But the anointing which you have received of him abides in you. Woo! He abideth. He abides in me. Oh, hallelujah, he abides in me. I'm rejoicing night and day, for he washed my sins away. And the Comforter abides with me. He abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you don't need anybody to tell you this. You don't need anybody to teach you this. You've been taught of God already. That's what the Holy Ghost is saying on the inside of you. He's screaming real loud. He's lifting up his voice. He's crying out and calling out to the sons of men. Teaching you all these things. And is truth and is no lie. Even as he's taught you, you must abide in him. Your life, your dwelling, your walking, your thinking, your purpose, everything that you believe about yourself, your being in his word. Not only living, dwelling in the living word. To live and dwell in the living word means you live and dwell in the written word. Jesus overcome all the powers of darkness with their best showing with simply quoting Deuteronomy 8, chapter 8 and verse 3. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. If you want to understand how to live this life, you live it by living it out. Living out what God said in his word and being it and doing it. Because when Father sees someone set and obeying him, all heaven's mobilized to their defense. When Father sees somebody set on having it his way, saying, no, I'm not going to have anything less than the full relationship that he wants me to have. And the full relationship that he wants me to have is that these works that he did, I do them and greater than that. The word relationship he wants me to have is that whatever I ask him, he will do it. That the Father may be glorified in the Son. I'm not having anything less. I'm not going to rewrite or redefine God's word based upon the fact that I prayed one time. I'm going to tell you right now, God's given us something far more than just praying one time. He wants to give his spirit knowledge so we'll speak to the rock and the water will come out. He wants to give his spirit knowledge to where that we'll say to the sun and the moon, don't move. And it has to obey. God wants to give his spirit knowledge. So we say to the axe head float, to the oil and to the flour, do not diminish, and it obeys. People get down on their knees and pray like God's going to come down and do something. He's given us an anointing to drive out sickness and disease. He's given us anointing to speak on his behalf, to command and declare how it's going to be, to write it out. This realm of faith that works by the anointing that subdues nations. Somebody said, oh, well, that was in the Old Testament that they could subdue nations and work righteousness and escape the edge of the sword and shut the mouths of lions, huh? And quench the violence of fire. No, they had a measure of what we got. That what we have available to us that very few people are taking advantage of. And I want to shake you today about your relationship with Jesus Christ and all the things that are distracting you to keep you from laying hold on this life of God, this eternal life, this glory, this sacred, this realm of heaven that, you will be opposed right, left, and center, and you're going to have to get you a backbone from heaven.
Amen.
You're going to have to get you some Holy Ghost zeal and determination. You're going to have to get yourself some violence,
amen,
aggressiveness, and take by force, hallelujah, that which God has given to you. That Satan, who is an opposer and a liar and a resister, who would oppose and defy God and his armies, you'll march right through it. You'll have an attitude like David. Who is this trying to tell me I got to live like this? Trying to talk to the people of God like this? I'm taking your head from you. I'm coming down into that valley where you stand. Oh, that's a fearful thing. Oh, it's nice to say that when you're just basically sitting in the meeting and you're listening to somebody minister this, but all of a sudden now you up against it. Huh? Now you confronting it. That you just too tired to go to church this morning. Are you trying to tell me that you liking that to David going down in the valley? That's where it starts. That's where it starts. And you rise up. You foul spirit of hell! You lying thing against the truth. I'm going to stay all day in the meeting just for that.
Yeah.
I'm not only going to church, I'm going to pray between the meetings. The sacred realms of God can't be taken lightly. Just have the Bible sitting on a shelf collecting dust when all the time God would have taught you. The Word of God's not in your language. We'll pray your language gets the Word of God. And if we have to wait too long, then someone will come who knows the Word of God and learn your language and speak as an oracle. Hallelujah, till you get it. Jesus said concerning the anointing in Luke chapter 4 and verse 18, look at it. He says concerning the anointing, the power of the anointing. God gives us the anointing to stand up in His stead and say, this is how it's going to be. He looks at us and says, well, what are you going to do with it? What's it going to look like? And we are so influenced by the mind of men around us, we say, well, we need to call the doc. Oh, we need to get some pain pills. Oh, we need to get a lawyer. Oh, it's bad. It looks terrible. Oh, my goodness. What are we going to do? We're going to die. They're going to kick us out of the house. Or whatever else we, prophesy and proclaim. Hear me now. God wants us to speak His word. He wants His word to go forth out of our mouth, which He has spoken, because it won't return again unto Him void. Hallelujah. But will accomplish those things which He has purposed. And I know what He's purposed because I've been reading the Bible. Hallelujah. I've been reading what's in His heart and in His mind. What is His will? Jesus said, the Holy Ghost is upon me. Hallelujah. Whew. Because He's anointed me. He's anointed me. He's given me the divine power. He's given me the divine ability. He's given me the divine equipment. Hallelujah. To preach the gospel to the poor. Not to pray, oh God, we pray. Of course, he couldn't say in his own name. I pray and ask you, touch these people. No, he sent, Father sent Jesus to touch the people. And he sent you to touch the people. Yes. And me to touch the people with the anointing. Not with some religious philosophical ideology. Come on now. Lord, help us. Because only you can break us free of it. Only you can open the eyes and the hearts of men. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you so that people don't walk around blind thinking they got something when they have very little of what you want. Listen to me. You it's okay if you say today that you don't have the full and you're desperate. Fine, because Father can work with that. But to act like you got the full and you need nothing else, you Laodicean. You Laodicean. You lukewarm. That's by definition like lukewarm. If you say that you see but you're blind, huh? You say that you got you clothed but you're naked, huh? You say that you got all the full and you need not have need of nothing, then you Laodicean. You lukewarm. You don't have enough fire to realize who you are and where you're at. Or in the worst possible place, well, actually, it's not worse because that's the worst possible place. Something that's not quite as bad as that is to be here in the place and say, no, I don't want God. Now, to us, that sounds worse, doesn't it? Because the person, no, they're here today, I don't want God. Well, that's not as bad as the person who's sitting in the meeting saying, I have need of nothing. I'm fine. You hear me? God said, I'd rather that you hot or cold. And when God defines hot, he's talking about on fire of the Holy Ghost. Because there's no other definition of hot in the Bible. There's no other definition. On fire of the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, the anointing has been placed upon me by the Holy Ghost. To go and to preach the gospel to the poor, to bind out the broken in heart. The authority to do it. The power to do it. And he's only got one ministry. And that one ministry he's given to us, and that should be our whole life and our whole existence. That's our ministry. That's who we are. So I said, I'm trying to find my ministry. You got to be kidding me, man. Your ministry is only discovered in Jesus. The anointing is telling you, get over in him. Dwell in him. Be one with him. Abide in him. You get to have this all day long. It'll cure your condemnation and your guilt and your offense and your shame and all the other stuff that Satan tries to do to marginalize what God's done with you and for you and wants to do through you. To proclaim liberty to captives and the open door to those that are in prison. To go turn people from Satan to God. I turn you right now. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. To open up the eyes of the blind. To turn them from darkness to light. We can see how, I believe it is Mark 6:13, how the anointing is applied there. And it's applied in a very unique way so that we can really see the fundamental application of what's been given to us that operates through us. We see that they went and cast out devils and anointed with oil those who were sick and healed them. See what the anointing will do? The anointing through a person. And then they didn't have to have a little circle prayer. Everybody join hands. Oh, God, we pray. Oh, if you can hear us today. And if it be so that you still are concerned about us and desire for us to come possibly not have as much pain as we've been having. All this doubt and unbelief prayer. Because the people don't say it that way, but that's what they mean. If it be thy will. Well, you need to know his will. Oh, he sent us to cast out devils and to heal the sick and to raise the dead. That's his will. He didn't say anywhere in Scripture, oh, time out. No, I don't really care about that anymore. Just go ahead and let people be sick and diseased. Don't worry about that. I want you to get a music team going. Huh? And I want you to have fish fries on Fridays. Huh? Huh? And then I want you to go over and feed the poor. And that's your assignment from here on in. And that's not what Jesus said. And that's not what the book of Acts, that's not what they did in the book of Acts. If they did that in the book of Acts, I'd start doing it with them. That's not what they did. They went everywhere preaching the gospel just like Jesus preached it. Yes. They went everywhere doing exactly what Jesus did. That's what a Christian is. A Christian isn't someone who sits all sad and lonely looking in church. who somewhere, sometime in their history said something about Jesus. Had somebody tell them that they were saved. Huh? Only God can tell you you're saved. And once He tells you you're saved, and you know you're saved, fruits, the fruits of the Spirit, the fruits will be manifested in your life. And I'm going to tell you right now, fruits are far more important than gifts. Though gifts are great and important, fruits are far more important than gifts, because you shall know them by their fruits. Listen to me right now. Gifts are deceptive and can be deceptive, rather. Huh? You know the false prophet? He looks like a lamb. Eh? He looks like a lamb. On the outside, he looks like a lamb. He's got signs and wonders and miracles. But when he opens his mouth, it sounds like the devil. He speaks like a dragon. Opens his mouth, it sounds just like the devil. His fruits, what's coming out of his mouth, his words, the declaration of his heart. Hello? Come on now. Father wants you to start living by the word, speaking the word, hallelujah. Reciting the word, proclaiming the word, hallelujah. The word, the living word, Christ Jesus, the living word. The written word's all about Him. You want the life and the power of Christ Jesus to begin to be manifest. You want all heaven mobilized. Start declaring the word. Huh? Look at the anointing. What does the anointing do? The anointing drives out sickness. Are you going to have to stand up against some pain? I've had to stand up against some pain. Somebody said, yeah, praise God. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Well, don't stop there. Don't stop there. Don't go with no half truth over here. Don't quote half of it. Continue. But the Lord delivers us out of them all. I mean, come on. You've got to go on with the program. I watch people get half of it and then try to make that the doctrine of God. Not the doctrine of God. Half of it's not the doctrine of God, because you filled in the blank. You took the half that was of God and put your half with it and said it's the Word of God. No, it isn't. Somebody says, oh, that's your interpretation. No, it's God's Word. And if you don't agree with it, it's your misinterpretation. Because you took God's Word and added it with your Word, and now it's your interpretation. But if it's just really simply God's Word, hallelujah. That's why you can have a game called Bible Trivia. If it was all up to everybody's interpretation, everybody wins, everybody gets every answer right, and it would be a boring game. Are you listening to me? There's a right answer and there's a wrong answer. Praise God for Bible trivia. Something had to come and be a referee in this argument. Hallelujah. We can enumerate the works that Jesus did and how He did them and hear Him plainly describe these works. Anybody who's got any belief, it's going to make me look hard here. Anyone who believes, these works shall they do in greater works. These signs, Jesus then says, these miracles follow those that believe. This is the testimony of them. They cast out devils. How? The anointing. There's the power and the glory, the divine ability of the living God resident in my mouth and in my heart and in my thinking to speak to the forces of hell, and they must obey me. They must obey you. Are you going to be opposed? Is the enemy going to try? Is the power of darkness and the rebellious imp called the devil going to try to shove you back into your little corner and tell you to be quiet? You have no power over him? Absolutely he is. If just devils that are in league with Satan, not Satan himself, are going to say to Jesus, we command you by the Most High God, leave us alone. You're not allowed to torment us before our time. What are they going to say to you? But Jesus continued to say, out. I said, out. Out. God's got to have a valiant people. God's got to have a valiant people. A friend of mine acted valiantly not too long ago in a situation where deaf mutes came in front of him and the cameras came out. He's down in Mexico and the Lord spoke to him and said, whatever you do, don't stop praying. 45 minutes later, he's still commanding the deaf to hear and the mute to speak. But 45 minutes later, the deaf heard and the mute began to speak. The mutes began to speak. Hallelujah. Because somebody's going to be valiant. Somebody's going to have an anointing. Somebody's going to know who they are. Somebody's going to stand up against the forces that says, you can't do this. You have no right to do it. You belong to me. Every time we're not moving in what God has purposed us to move in, Satan's trying to tell us that we still belong to him and that he can tell us what we can and cannot do. And I'm going to tell you right now, when you finally hear it, you're going to get yourself fighting mad. I'm going to tell you right now. Hallelujah. Fighting mad. You're tired of being picked on. You're tired of everybody slapping you around. Now with total abandonment, you all fist and feet and teeth. Amen. Hallelujah. Elbows, knees, everything. You don't care how bad you get beat up. It doesn't matter. This is ending. This is ending. Everyone's going to know that if they mess with you, they're going to get hurt. And is it really worth it? Because nobody has much bragging rights when they all beat up. You know what I'm saying? Yes. It comes to a finality with how the enemy believes that he can run over top of you. Paul was raised from the dead. I don't know how many people he raised from the dead, but I do know how many times he was shipwrecked. I don't know how many blind eyes he opened. I guarantee there was a lot, but I do know how many times he was beaten with rods and with whips for the name of Jesus. I want you to think about it. Because I'm telling you, we got a great company of saints surrounding us right now, telling us that we can run this race and that we can do what God told us to do. Amen. We're surrounded by so great a company of witnesses right now in the camp of faith. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. And I can see some of them saying, God, they let me back into the fight. I can just see Elijah. Pacing, you know. What are they doing? Huh? Can you just see Paul? Oh, Lord, come on. There's nobody moving down there. That's like, look at them. They're all just sitting around singing songs. Look at them. Look at them. They're all sitting around singing songs and counting their money. Oh, God, let me back in. Are you listening to me? Yes. I don't want people glaring at me when I get in heaven. Come on now. Come on now. I would rather there be an applaud. Here he comes. Somebody gave it all. In the midst. Come on now. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you can try to make it different, but it's going to be that way. I'll prove it to you in the Word. You can see me after the meeting. It's going to be that way. I'm not going to have some nosebleed section up in, you know, in heaven behind the innumerable company of saints. I'm auditioning to be right in front of him, worshiping him and praising him like nobody else except for maybe the seraphim. And then I will find out that they couldn't hold a candle to what God's going to do through me and through you. Yes. In worship and praise. Yes. That they have to be silent when I begin to talk about redeemed. Hallelujah. When I begin to talk about how I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Fully demonized. The power of God came and set me free, and I yielded myself to be shaped in his image and his likeness, and have completely come out from that realm to where that I would never, there is never going to be a risk that you and I as his saints will ever do what Satan did, to rebel against him again. I want you to stand with me. I want you to think about what I've said. Because I preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to you. There are people that are standing around and they think that they're going to live forever. They think that they're going to live. Now you say, well, I'm going to live to 70. I'm going to live to 80. I'm going to live to 90. Whatever. No. Joshua, the house church leader Joshua, who was here in the church with us. He and his wife died instantly in a car accident yesterday. Instantaneously, they went from where they were into eternity. And I'm telling you, your life is very, very fragile. You think you got a hold on it. You listen to me. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to wake you up and prepare you. I'm not interested in ever thinking that somebody stood in a place where I was preaching and ministering by the Holy Ghost and ended up in an eternity without God, because hell's going to be hotter for you, those people who've been in the, under the anointed Word of God. You don't have time. There's no room for delay. That's called procrastination. Procrastinators unite tomorrow. It's just over. Procrastination means that you're never going to go into the today. It's always going to be delayed. It's always going to be sometime in the future. And the more you delay it, the more you are literally imprisoned to never be able to decide to move forward. Today is your opportunity to get right with God. Somebody said, well, I'm not so bad. You know, I try to be good. Somebody said, all these various different scenarios. I'm going to tell you right now, until you're transformed by the power of God that can only come to pass by the miracle authority that is in the name of Jesus Christ, I want you to understand me right now. You are dead in your trespasses and sin, and you will forever be in a place separated from God in eternity called the lake of fire. You are not good enough for God, and you can never be good enough for God because of the offense of sin and iniquity. But God made a way through Christ Jesus that you could be transformed and become holy and acceptable and everything that pleases the Father. It becomes a gift of righteousness and holiness. But listen to me about the covenant of the gift. God gives us a gift of righteousness, and He gives us the gift of holiness. And the deal is this: that we are willing to be taught righteousness and taught holiness. And to violate that, you annul the contract. You'll annul it. The contract would be annulled if you want to continue on in unrighteousness and continue on in unholiness. God's people are marked by a continual passion of hunger and thirst after righteousness. God's people are marked by a continual hunger and thirst after change. After having everything that belongs to God established in their life. Today, Father's given you an opportunity to get right. To repent. To call upon the name of Jesus. Some of you have called upon the name of Jesus and you need to repent. There are people who've spoken against the things of God, who've spoken against other people, have been involved in strife, and been involved in rebellion, and they've self-justified, but sin marks them. And because they believe that they are right in doing so, they continue to be marked by that sin, and they will die in their sins. God in His mercy has provided a way to where that if we sin, there's the blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse us if we confess the sin. There are people that believe that we're going to just sin more or less every day, and so they lie and do things wrong, and their hearts are hardened and calloused and seared because they bought into a lie, and they have lied. They have said wrong. They have lied. They've told lies, and they've never repented. They're marked with sin. They've lied. They've involved themselves in strife and envy, and they raise their hands and worship to God and say, I'm fine. It's called seared. Seared. It's where you lose all feeling. Seared with a hot iron. It burned right down through to your nerves. You can't feel no more. God, in His love and mercy, shines a floodlight upon your heart and your soul right now. And He pleads with you. Can you see, God the Holy Ghost is the pleader. He pleads. God's pleading with us. The word that actually defines the Holy Ghost, outside of Holy Ghost, is parakleion, from where we get parakletos. Which many people pronounce as parakletos. Parakletos. And it means to plead. God, Holy Ghost, pleading with you. Will you respond today? here in this place, will you respond? If there's things that have been going on in your life that are not right, you can just ask the blood of Jesus, come cleanse you. You can ask Holy Ghost, come strengthen you to do what's right from here on in. Right now in the name of Jesus, I break off the strongholds of hell. Right now in Jesus' name. Maybe you've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe your life has never been changed. Maybe you don't understand it. Maybe you've just been, you were hijacked or kidnapped by religion. And you don't realize that God's going to give you a new heart and He's going to give you a new spirit. And it's a heart that's tender towards God. It's a spirit that is tender towards God. And then it'll fill you with the Holy Ghost. It'll make you a new creation. I mean, Nicodemus understood exactly what Jesus was saying, because he said, how can a man, when he's old, enter the second time into his mother's womb? Because Jesus was radically saying, you, if you're going to come into heaven, if you're going to come into the kingdom of God, if you're going to know who I really am, then you're going to have to be changed. You're going to have to be born again, born from above, not of this world. Nicodemus, being the ruler of the Jews, being a very devout religious man, said, how can a man enter the second time into his mother's womb? Jesus said, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. And today, God wants to make a work of miracle for you. God wants to work a miracle for you. Huh? Will you let Him? All you have to do is call upon the name of Jesus. God has vested all power and authority in that name. A miracle will take place. If that's you, we want to pray with you and for you. God will change you. But I'm going to tell you right now, If you're living in a backslidden state, I want you to understand that backslidden state is just probably even a worse serious state than the person who's never first called upon the name of the Lord, because a backslidden state can be self-justified and you can be in it and be deceived. God is calling you. He wants you to get right. If you're uncertain, God is calling you. He wants you to get right. He wants you to get right. He wants to bring you to a place where all the things and all the of hell and all the forces of darkness can no longer impact your life with respect to your decisions and your choices. Jesus is calling you. What will you do? He's calling you to come. Is there anyone here? You want to get right with God? You better get right with God, because I'm telling you right now, you're going to fall, you're going to stand before the living God, and the scripture says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. What will you do with Jesus today? What will you do with what He did for you at Calvary's cross, the expense that He paid? What will you do with the sacred things that are so sacred and precious to God? He wouldn't let and protects it against all violation, and now He's opened up the door that you may freely have these things. What are you going to do with the sacred things of God? How are you going to respond and react to Him? The Holy Ghost is pleading with you. You can come right now and we'll pray with you. The Holy Ghost is pleading with you. Father, I thank You that You open up the eyes of the blind. Because I'm simply not going to believe that there's anyone in here who would defiantly say no to God. It would only just be a result of deception, not knowing. But I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that every eye will be open, that the Holy Ghost conviction power will be so fiery, it'd be impossible for you to resist. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Now I'm going to also call for those who are sick or got disease in your body here in just a minute. And you know, if you want to just slip up here while I'm praying for the sick, because you know your soul is hurting, you know your spirit is hurting, you know that inside spiritually things aren't right, you can just slip up here and I'll pray for you too. Because we want you burning with the fire of heaven. We want you to respond to what God the Holy Ghost is saying. He's saying, come and dwell in Jesus. Jesus is saying, come and learn of me. He's saying, come walk in me, walk with me. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We're getting ready. I wanted to just lay this on you. It's so important. We're getting ready to build a church out on the Mission Training Center. Our plans are to build the church out there in July. And it's going to take us about $60,000. And so if you'll start sowing and praying and believing God now for that, you know, and it would just really take 60 people saving $1,000 between now and then, and it's paid for. And so I just want to encourage all of you to be a part of that, of the building of that church. Because that church is going to be fiery. It's going to be filled with the fire and the glory of heaven. Hallelujah. Hadeshikina Mambradai. Going to have some fiery pastors in it. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Yes. Pastor Daniel in the summer. Hallelujah. Pastor D and Summy. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah. The only reason we need any finances to go be financed to go declare the word of life. And I pray that every one of you just take that. I mean, we've got places for you all over the world. There's that much more need in China now. Joshua and his wife's been taken out. Joshua started so many. He's one of the primary house leaders of China. He started so many farms that were covert operations for raising up leaders and pastors. And we're right in the big middle of all that. So, I mean, there's so many places across the earth. Hallelujah. People need to go labor. There's 3 billion people that have never heard. 3 billion. Praise God. We're going to go.
We're going to go.
Amen.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Brittany, you're going to go. Hallelujah. I put all of your names on there too. Annalyn, Jacqueline. I'll just get everybody up front. Martha. Leslie. Gonna go.
Amen.
No, you already just it's already done.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Just come worship the Lord with your offering, with tithing with your offering. Bless him, honor him. He blesses you and honors you. You bless him and honor him. Hallelujah. Whew. Hallelujah. Once again, if anybody's got sickness or disease in your body, there's a foul stomach flu going around. Respiratory virus and all that stuff. I bind that ugly thing, demonic thing in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise God. And now I'm going to have any sickness or disease in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The healer is here. Here to heal you today. Mombrasadeki and Masati. Hazada de Sagina. Hala Mamasati. Thank you, Jesus. Healers here to heal you today. Hallelujah. You've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. God, the Holy Ghost is here to baptize you. Whatever you need. This is time where we're going to pray specifically for whatever you need. Hallelujah. And Monsatarinea. The Lord's going to touch you. Don't get all, you stay in Thanksgiving. Pour out your complaint and agonize someplace else. Because right now, I never heard anybody receive anything till they broke through to Thanksgiving. Agonizing is only there to break through to faith and Thanksgiving. Are you listening to me? Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you for the authority and the anointing to stand up against it. To stand up against it. It's exactly what I did. You're doing exactly what I did. The thing tried to come on me, and I just get right up in his face, come to the meeting, get right up in his face. Preach. Feeling like, you know, I was about to die. Preach. Just preach. Get right up in his face and preach. Hallelujah. Not bow to it. Not bend to it. And some of you, you know, you weren't so blessed. You didn't get hit by it on Sunday. You got hit by it on Saturday. So you didn't get the opportunity to stand up in his face. I tell you, let me just tell you right now. You ain't going to ever have no sickness and disease.
Amen.
You ain't going to have it. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. And tell all you girls, this is what you got to do in the morning, on Sunday morning, and whatever you get dressed in, you got to do every maneuver that you're going to do in church. Like, got to let your hands all as high as you can, because that's how short your dress is going to be. Hey, are you with me? Huh? Maybe you might go ahead and fall down on the floor to see what it's going to look like. That's what you got to do. You got to prepare. Hallelujah. 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 And it slips by all of us. The other day I had a shirt on. I was showing my stomach. When I raised my hands, my wife said, "Honey." I said, "Oops. Who got me that shirt?" Be healed. I just command it right now in Jesus' name. For you to be healed. I demand it. Hallelujah. Be filled. Filled with good things. Huh? Filled. Filled. Mom Zande. Brushaya. Elisete. Elisete. Somebody said to me one time, they said, "What should I pray when I go to pray?" I said, "I would pray this. Holy Ghost, teach me how to walk in humility. And how to walk in love." I want you to get real, because all those other stuff, you've overvalued it. All those other things, you overvalued it. Your finances, overvalued, huh? Your various physical situations, overvalued. Why don't you get to the heart of the matter? Teach me, Lord, how to walk in humility and love. I want to walk, let me become so sensitive to everything contrary to that. Hallelujah. Oh, all the rest will be taken care of. Go for the big thing. Go for the big. Go for the gold. Go for the gold, don't go for the bronze. Go for the gold. Amen. Hallelujah. Shikaropo. 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 Hallelujah. Shikaropo. Shikaro. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Nendalapa. Mange. Shikaropa last. Seredenya. Seremana. Shikaropo. Receive right now. Shikaropo. Receive what you need right now. Right now. Mahadehi. Mandashi. Receive right now. Receive right now. Receive right now. Receive right now. Receive. 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 Jesus. Receive. Take hold of it. Take hold of what God has for you. Hallelujah. Mandeo. Mandebea balanea basatea rimagala mangalista peridai. Ast. Manas. Este. Mosteka. Hallelujah. Brosan. Brerea. Brea. Brea this year in the Monte. Brea said, receive right now. Receive right now. Take hold of it. Take hold of it. Take hold of him. Take hold of him. Rinast. Hmm?
Jesus.
Brosa te kisht. Brosa kisht. Brosa tan. Brosa te fishti. Right now in Jesus' name.
Freed.
In Jesus' name.
Freed.
Right now in Jesus' name. Every yoke broken right now. Every yoke broken right now.
Freed.
Heaven's glory right now. Everything of the past in Jesus' name completely and totally broken off of you. Every hurt, every offense, every doubt, every power of darkness and of religion. So you can walk over in the realms of this divine glory. Be filled right now with the Holy Ghost. Be filled right now with the Spirit of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for this peace and for this love and for this joy. Thank you for this life forever. Now in Jesus' name. Jesus. Such power in your name, Lord. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Jesus. From darkness to light. From the power of hell, power of heaven. From the realms of Satan to the realms of God. Every part of your mind and every part of your thinking. And I command and curse every pain go out of your body now in the name of Jesus. No more migraine headaches. In Jesus' name. No more afflicting headaches in Jesus' name. Yeah. Father, I thank you for the healing touch right now. There it is. Spirit, soul, and body. There it is. The touch of heaven. That's it. It's the touch of heaven. Mom, just come here. You feel better, don't you? Come here. Come here. Yeah, you do. You feel better, don't you? Mom, just. Hallelujah. Mom, this Easter. Brassat. Brassat. No more strife. No more strife then. There's no more strife. It takes two to enter into strife, so just no more strife. And the Lord hears you right now, so just don't do it anymore. So we're not doing that anymore. Did you know that someone who wants to argue really just does everything they can possibly do to pull you into the argument? And did you know that it's a spirit? It's not a problem or an issue. It's a spirit. And that if you just start taking authority over the spirit out loud, you're going to add fuel to the fire. You just say, listen, all I want to talk about is how much Jesus loves us. All I want to talk about is how filled with the Holy Ghost we can be. How good it is that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's all I want to talk about. Somebody said to me not too long ago, they said, what do you do if such and such a sickness happens? I said, I don't even want to talk about it. I only want to talk about how not having it happen. I'm going to talk about what are you going to do once it happens. I don't even know what you're going to do. It doesn't even matter. I don't have anything scriptures for that. Other than to get healed.
Amen? Somebody said, where do I define the difference between my responsibility and what I'm supposed to trust God with? Well, let me just tell you. You entrust everything and everybody to the Word of God. Your responsibility is to declare the Word of God. That's what your responsibility is. Huh? That's it. Hallelujah. Praise God. And then the Lord takes it from there. But rabasa, just be refreshed, be filled. The Lord wants to give you fresh oil. He wants to give you fresh oil. Fresh oil. Bam dest este kist. Fresh air de bat. What's happening with you?
I'm feeling a little sick.
You're feeling a little sick? Okay. Well, that's, so you say you got a little sick in the body and a little sick in the spirit.
Yes.
Gotcha. What, do you believe that the Lord would heal you right now?
Yes.
He'll heal you right now. He'll heal you right now. Did you know that stomach flu is actually a spirit and you can deal with it that way? I know people around you told you it was a virus. Ask them specifically what that is. And especially a virologist or a clinical scientist. Go ahead and ask them, can you tell me exactly what that is and how that works? And when they're finished explaining to you and they realize that they don't know what they're talking about and you realize that they don't know what they're talking about, then go ahead and understand what I'm talking about. You can deal with it as a spirit. Hallelujah. And be healed right now. And be healed right now. And resist the thing. Resist it steadfast in the faith. And resist the other stuff. Amen. The hurts and the complaint and whatever else might be there. Trying to be there. Amen. Just receive right now. Touch. Lord, touch it. You touch it. You touch it. You want to touch it. You want to feel it. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord could do a lot for somebody who's got problems or issues or things that they're challenged with when they're getting prayer. There are some people that believe that they're the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher, and saint all wrapped up in one big package. Did you know that? Did you know that? And they've never even brought one person to Jesus. They've never even reached one soul. Did you know that? That's true. That's true. It happens all the time. It's called arrogance. It is. It's a spirit. It's a demon spirit. Did you know that people actually mistaken that for the Holy Ghost? Could you imagine people mistaking a demon spirit for the Holy Ghost? Ouch. You know why? They perish for lack of knowledge. They don't know the word. I'm not talking to you. I'm praying for you talking to somebody else. Just to make sure that you... Because a lot of times I do lay hands on people and I start addressing stuff. But other times I don't. So don't. Be careful. Amen. What do you want?
I'm taking thyroxine for low thyroid. I want to heal
completely. Low problem with thyroid? Okay, thyroid healed and no more medication.
Yes, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thyroid healed and no more medication. And so you believe that Christ Jesus is here to do this and the anointing's here to break off that yoke.
Amen.
Because that's what the anointing's for.
Hallelujah.
Arabakashaya. So in the name of Jesus Christ, this thyroid works. Hallelujah. Properly. And no more need for medication. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And now just be filled up and be refreshed and be overwhelmed with the glory of heaven. Labanda de beste que de mambrusta. Barenda de kiste de nepa da longa masata.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Berestanda. Burasateya. Whatever it is that you need. Whatever it is that you need. Whatever it is that you need, just receive right now. Whatever it is that you need, just receive right now. Brasatagina namasatai. Brasatatina namakasaya. Thank you, Jesus. What is it? What's up? What's happening?
He's still got a little bit of a cough.
Oh, cough, get off the man of God. Get off of him now, in Jesus' name. Leave his body. Right now, in the name of Jesus, the infection goes out of the lungs. Thank you, Lord, the joy and the rejoicing. Thank you, Father, for the shouts of praise. Thanksgiving. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Huh. Let that praise just flow up out of your innermost being right now. Let that praise just flow right up out of your innermost being right now. Let that praise just out of day of pride. Just let that praise just flow right up out of that I see. Let that praise just flow right up out of your innermost being right now. Let that praise, Lord of Asisa. Let that praise just flow right up out of your innermost being. Let that praise just flow right up out of your innermost being right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brunda deshteke deshte prenasu zidaya. Let that praise just flow right up out of your innermost being. Rebesidadu zivritish. Moranga desheya tereshi ikina bujat. Membrenesht. Merenashte. Merenashte. Be anointed with fresh oil. Right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. Ha ha ha. Then manda sheyete. Mayena sheyete bayorobo. Mayena sherita yaramosata. Mayena sherita jalashakoshe. Mayena sharana nanaya da sete yaha. Marina Shatanda Lanenga de Yesh. Yeah, Radai. Yeah. 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 Bronda Yashende. Abba Dagaya. Mayana Nanashe. Mayana Nanana Mashe. Mayana Nana. Mayana Nana Mazada. Ha. Yere Bangala Mashe. Ya. Ya. Hallelujah. Halabada de Shea. Thank you, Jesus. What do you want?
Greater passion.
Thank you, Jesus. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, greater passion. Greater passion. Greater passion. Greater passion for the things of heaven. Thank you, Father, for this anointing. Right now, in the name of Jesus, out of your innermost being begins to flow rivers of the Holy Ghost. Right now, receive. Right now, receive. Rabosta. Right now, receive. 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 Adam Brazadege. Receive. Ma, receive. Astareteya. Receive. Alamongjeka. Ambrosate. Ixe tulo boshe. Receive. Risadori. Ha ha ha. Brennan Jesetolo. Bekliosta. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Jesus. Jesus. Whatever you want, you can have it right now. What do you want? Father, we thank you for increasing the anointing. Chinela con Spirito Santo. Ora mismo. Ora. Ora. Hallelujah. Ora. Ora. Chinela con goza. Hallelujah. Andai a regia da namasea. Chinela con goza. Yes, si adea, yeah, via zea, ramai, desia. Aria, tia. Aria, aria. Mandeia se brennan ben doste. Man blanje kaio, probo se avran. Then they backste, eat it is. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Rebo se breda. Woohoo! Thank you, Lord, for your mighty power. Thank you, Lord, for the anointing right here. Rezando, recebeke, recebe, ribando shea, rebazuzande, rebaso darrenenge, mambanjaso. Oh, mandeya, say, oh, mandeya. Rise up, almighty men of God, and put on your valor now. rise up and take your place in heaven among those who belong to the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies. Be not separated unto men, but separated unto God. Know about the divine condition, not the human one. And let the Spirit of the Lord take in and fill the ranks. Father wants to take you and fill the ranks. He wants to take you and fill the ranks with your life. Hallelujah. Right now in Jesus' name, right out of your innermost being, begins to flow the issues of divine power and glory.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. No sickness touch your body either in Jesus' name. God, get off of you. Can't mess with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What's up over here?
You don't do it that way. Right there? Where's it at?
Dissolve.
Is it real painful?
No, not anymore. I mean,
dissolve. Dissolve. I command this growth to dissolve. Commanded to dissolve. Right now. Out of there. Out. Out.
Yes.
There's a place where it gets real easy. Honestly, there's a place where healing America's become real easy. Ann said to me the other day, she had some growth on her forehead, and I said, where? Right there? And I just, right there? And it was gone, immediately gone. It's off. And, you know, we want it to be that easy all the time. The Lord wants it to be that easy all the time. And you just learn, especially as the people of God, because the lost, it's really easy to get the lost healed. But as the people of God, you've got to learn how to hook up with the anointing. You've got to learn how to become a part of the body of Christ. If you want to try to be
I don't know. I don't understand how people think they can be the body of Christ all by themselves. You know what I'm saying? Body of Christ all by themselves, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. They don't need anybody to tell them anything. It's all one big, gigantic, independent unit. That's hurt. You know what that is? See, that's why there's so many people hurt and offended. And that's what the result is. They just go off by themselves. And the only love that they really know is what they get from their puppy dog. No, I've had people say, the only real love I really even get is from my dog. I'm like, I hope you're not telling me something that's supposed to be a blessing on your behalf, because that's sad. Because there's so much love of God. People always saying, well, I don't see any love. No, it's because you're in hurt and offense, because there's love all over the place. You can interview almost everybody in this place and they'll tell you about how much love's in here. I mean, I get a liquid, tangible love. But you get somebody who's offended and in a prison of hurt, and they don't see love anywhere. And so they're going to blame everything on everybody else of what's going on in their own life, because that's the way it is. People judge out of what's going on in their own life. I said to a prophet one time, I said, he's an older man of God, I said, have you ever noticed that what's ever going on in people's lives, that they try to put it off on you? He said, yeah, that's the way it works. It's just part of the manifestation of it. And that's why people, they'll look at all these various different things, especially when it comes to church and there not being any love in it. Huh? Listen, that's a stronghold of demonic. If that's been going on and harassing your thoughts and your mind, I want you to understand, Holy Ghost never said that. Holy Ghost doesn't even speak that way. Those things are irrelevant to the Holy Ghost. You know why? Because he sends you and me to go bring the love. Right? So he sends us to go lay down life. That is purely a demonic realm. And everybody who knows God knows that there's a purely demonic realm. But those who've been sorted out by the enemy don't even understand. They don't know. They can have 5,000 people standing in front of them saying it's purely demonic realm, and they're going to be convinced that they're the only one right and the 5,000 are wrong, because that's the stronghold of deception. Huh? And we want to be a part of helping you get fortified, first of all, delivered, and then fortified against what the powers of darkness is trying to do. And the way to walk out this glorious life is to be continually filled with the Spirit of the Lord. And when you're continually filled with the Spirit of the Lord, it's easy for you to receive. The further you are from being continually filled with the Spirit of the Lord, it's hard to receive. Are we going to kick you out? No. We're going to continue to lay hands on you until you get so sensitive to the things of the Spirit, because you just continue to receive. And then you receive it, the things of the Holy Ghost, right to where your need is. Hallelujah. Home broom died. Because you know what? The Lord can touch you. I've watched people get healed, go outside, listen to a lie, and come right back under it. Listen, there's people who say, oh, it's a lying symptom. No, it's only a lying symptom after you've been healed. Okay? But once you've been healed and the thing tries to come back on you, I could bring people in here, I could get to testify right now, where the Lord radically healed them, almost on a deathbed condition. And then several months later, the thing tried to come right back on them. I was just told that Ginger, who got healed of an incurable disease, Lyme disease, and went to the hospital and had all the tests, proved that she was totally cured. Miracle. Walking around, just miracle, so blessed. Because I spent some time with her, just so blessed, no pain-free, just nothing. That now she's back in a bed of affliction with the symptoms of it. Well, that's lying symptoms there. Yes, it is. That's a lie. That's Satan trying to come back and impose that sickness back upon her. Well, then see, what we've got to understand is how to take the anointing, and when the enemy tries to impose it back on us, go, no, I'm not bowing. I'm not going to bow over. I'm not going to, like I was using endometriosis as a description, I'm not going to bow to it. I'm going to stand, I'm going to face this thing down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that's what the Lord wants you to do. He wants you to stand, and he wants you to face it down. And they say, I'm not able, and they say, I don't have the strength. You may not be able, and you may not have the strength, but God, the Holy Ghost, is able, and he has the strength, and he wants to fill you with it. Amen. I mean, because you know how to receive from heaven, you just got to be able to receive in the time of adversity. What do you need in the day of adversity? Joy. The joy of the Lord should be your strength in the day of adversity. Ah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. prada dobrebe stikita hipra. There's some of you, if I just spent 1 week with you in a meeting every day, 1 week, everything would be changed. 1 week every day. Because it's called a breakthrough. It's called a breakthrough. So saturation with the word, saturation with the things of the spirit, and then all of a sudden it becomes easy. Huh? So somebody said, I want you to do that. Okay, I'll do that. First, you get in all the meetings that we already have. You with me?
Yes.
Somebody said to me, oh, I want somebody to mentor me. What are you talking about, man? I see like once a week. I see on Sunday morning. Why don't you come Sunday night, Wednesday night, Friday night? And then tell me you need more. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you start participating fully in what is already available. Amen. And you're going to get everything that you need. You take what is already available, what God is speaking, what God is declaring, and you do it.
Amen.
You do it.
Amen.
All these people I prayed for from Kerala, I'm getting this amazing burden for Kerala. I am. I figure Kerala needs to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Kerala needs to learn how to receive from the anointing. Huh? Arazadeke. Mondadeste. Hazadega. Mongadeshabe. Ah. Mandakeashe. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Brasagishti. Mandefest. I'm going to start with you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Jesus prefest. Subandalabeke. Jesus. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. It's Jesus' ministry. You reckon Jesus wants to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire? What do you think's going on? You think he can get to you? Huh?
I don't know.
You don't know? I tell you he can get to you, he's in you. He's in you. He's either in you or you disqualified or you reprobate. And you're not reprobate. He's in you. He is. That's what you're supposed to know. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You just stay right there where you're at right now. Huh? That big smile on your face. Amen. And just thanking him for the wonderful baptism in the Holy Ghost. Just like on the day of Pentecost, as it's recorded in the book of Acts. Were you here on Friday night? You weren't here on Friday night. You should have been here. You were out of town?
No, I was in town.
You was in town and you didn't come? Okay. Try it. When we do Friday nights, you need to come. I was feeling the verge of an explosion Friday night with everybody that was in here. I think I'm going to quit announcing that it's just an hour. Because people think it's expectation for an hour, you know. It's glory. It's glory. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody said, but we were already planning on a fish fry Friday night. I hope that fish was really good. I hope that fish has eternal weight in glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the name. Well, praise God. We'll see all of you tonight. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Everybody's going to be healthy and strong, blessed. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.